I'm Phil Kaufman. I directed Invasion of the Body Snatchers. We began somewhere in outer space, on the outer reaches of the universe, strange planet. Unfortunately, titles were put over the sequence. Try to watch it without the titles. It's a planet that might very well be the Earth in some future time. Barren rock, a few gelatinous spores suddenly set loose. These are the spores that are trying to survive. And since this planet is barren, beaten by the Earth, and devoid of human forms that we recognize, they've pretty much exhausted that planet. And now they drift off into space looking for new planets to conquer. So in a way, we began this film from the point of view of what is to become known as the pods. I knew we needed a sequence to show the genealogy of pods. Couldn't figure out what to do. Finally, in an art store in San Francisco, I came across this gel, this clear gel, somehow, I guess, used in mixing paints and so forth. And I went to some guys in Los Angeles, Ron Dexter and Howard Preston, and by just dropping this gel into water and then reversing the motion and putting, you know, the planets in the background. So, I mean, this was all done as you see it, just being shot from various angles and with minimal kinds of effects. The gel itself, I think, cost $5 for the movie. This was about as minimal an effect as you could possibly get, but it, to me, has the organic feeling of what we were looking for as these things move towards our planet here. And they find this kind of fecund, fog-laden place, San Francisco. And there's the Transamerica Tower, which will be seen throughout the movie. Transamerica was, in fact, the company that was backing United Artists, which produced the movie. We sometimes refer to it as Pod Central. No offense intended, particularly. We kept using the same, you know, the gel from the same bottle here. This is the kind of gel that you see, you know, that spiders might leave. The kind of thing, you know, that you would see in a rainy season, you'd never really notice, but it's all around. It might be seeds of plants. Even here in the runoff, you can see it bubbling and foaming. And we're still working on this $5 bottle of gel here. And it's got kind of an oozing, awful look to it, but innocent. And in a way, the pods are innocent. They're just doing what they do best, which is, as we see here, to reproduce. Right at the beginning, you're getting the beginnings of how all of this process works. They come from outer space, and now they begin to sprout roots, really. They begin to take root. These were all special effects done by our special effects team. They were done, probably, my memory is that these were done in reverse. The flowers were pulled in. It was easier to pull them in than to push them out. And so the effect, same with the tentacles. If you start with them out and then pull them in, it has the effect of growing. Right from the beginning, we wanted to establish the paranoid nature of this woman's face who looks suspiciously at Brooke Adams. Duvall, for some reason, had come through San Francisco, and I just got the idea of putting Duvall in a priest's garb. My feeling was that if you're doing a horror movie, there should be a priest in it. In a sense, he's the first pod of all that you see in the movie, the priest pod. Duvall did it for no money. I think we gave him a coat from Eddie Bauer's to keep him warm. He just wouldn't take any money for doing it. We have these kind of strange angles that San Francisco grows on. And these are the old sort of organic houses of San Francisco, plants hanging everywhere in the house.
Hello?
This is the interior of the actual house that she walked into. By and large, I don't remember that we really did any sets. I think we'd use practical locations throughout the movie, except for the very ending, which was in fact just a big warehouse. Adding to the kind of cockeyed, mysterious nature, I just decided to shoot this scene down the hall and see or feel things in passing.
GREX, that's when two different species cross-pollinate and produce a third completely unique one. And listen to this. Epilobic. From the Greek epi, upon, and lobos, upon. Many of the species are dangerous.
Already we're starting to set up some of the lighting effects. You can see the kind of greens and kind of purplish lighting effects in the greenhouse. It was very San Francisco kind of thing, you know, where people were into a lot of interior plants in the house and so forth. By not really showing the actors in the scene, only seeing them in reflection and so forth, it added to the creepiness and to the fun of the movie.
Okay, maybe. Sure. Jeffrey, I'm trying to read. You're in a good mood.
Well, I got something to look forward to tonight. Why are you?
Jeffrey?
What?
I'm reading.
Okay, I'll put the earphones on. There, see? You happy?
Never mind. I'll go downstairs.
Come on. Gila.
Music.
Department of Health.
You really have to establish the mood right from the beginning. It has to be part of your game plan, really. Even here, everything is a little cockeyed. Everything is skewed. Everybody is a little bit clammy, and there's something wrong in the city. But there is something wrong in the city. There's something wrong in every city, but we, with our optimism, often tend to overlook it. But in this film, we just decided to show all the things that are a little bit awry. And see, even here, all the cooks are looking at him because he's sort of intruding on how they make their living, which is sort of the Jaws theme writ small, that they'll all be out of business if word gets out that there's a rat turd in the kitchen.
A good young burgundy, brown stock, thyme, parsley, just a sprig, capers, a fresh bay leaf, and garlic.
That's all?
Oui, yes.
What is that?
A caper.
No.
Presume to tell us what is in the stock?
It's a rat turd.
A what?
A rat turd.
A caper.
A rat turd.
A caper.
If it's a caper, eat it.
There's actually a place called Bimbo's just down the street from where we're recording right now. It's about a block away from here. And it's sometimes used for shows, but it's also a restaurant that is an active restaurant at times. Here's that same, using this kind of lighting, this ultraviolet kind of purple lighting that sort of works throughout the film. So now Donald comes and he finds what we always find in big cities. I have this happen quite a bit to my car. The windshield gets cracked, and you never quite know who did it or what. As you look around, there's always some hostile, suspicious faces looking at you. But again, the crack sort of echoes the tentacles of the pods as they were sprouting. It's a little forewarning of things. There, the motorcycle going by, we'll see that later in tunnels. Already, there's something on the move here. There's something strange and suspicious lurking in the city. Michael Chapman's a great handheld cameraman who had been the operator on the Godfather movies and the earlier ones. Is a great cameraman himself, besides being a great director of photography.
I threw a bottle of wine at it. Not even good wine.
Yeah, the Warriors won, so I guess your household is pretty happy.
Yes.
What are you doing?
Oh, nothing.
If you go to sleep now, you can get up early in the morning, couldn't you?
Oh, Matthew.
If you can come in at 7:30, you can run the tests and you can get the stuff started before 8 o'clock.
Stop, Matthew. Matthew, stop. I'm not coming in before 8 o'clock in the morning. No!
I got to force the abatement hearing.
So here it's this kind of murky film noir thing, trying to go as black as possible around the edges to show as little color as possible. Not too many films had played with this at this time. Most films back then were trying to light everything up, and a few cinematographers like Gordon Willis were experimenting. See the shadows there. That cord going into the wall was just another little fun, spooky thing that we thought the way things work, which we often don't notice, are often the things that can be the scariest. This shot is a nice shot because the camera, we didn't have an elaborate crane. We sort of constructed something with a little crane right above them on the bed and moving down. This is before they had those remote control cranes. The camera's moving across them, arriving on, and here you see the purple lighting again. Pods thrive in this kind of ultraviolet light. And we know what this pod is capable of, and now we're about to see its next manifestation of the pods. Here Jeffrey's cleaning up a little of the residue of his former self. Again, even though something's changed about Jeffrey, he's pretty much like the normal man of the future. He's dressed up, he looks pretty snappy, actually.
Jeffrey?
This is a handheld shot moving around. Tried to do as much of this in one shot as possible. It just makes things a little spookier than constant cutting back and forth. Framing should always be a little askew, a little quick moves like this. And the garbage men are obviously in on it because the whole garbage bin is filled with the same kind of residue. So we know that through the night, a lot of people have been converted, and the garbage man is obviously in some sort of cahoots with Jeffrey here. The city workers are involved, and these are the noises you hear outside your house all the time on the street, carrying things magically away. There's something going on, and Jeffrey's sort of seeing his former self being carried away there. This is a motif too, a man running away from things. Later we'll see people just running down the street. It's always upsetting to see somehow people in suits running on a street. And you never know quite what's going on. This guy will appear later. It was Jerry Garcia laying in the banjo sounds. I didn't know Jerry at the time. I got to know him later, but a woman who was working on the sound effects, Susan Crutcher, was a friend of his, and she was, laying in the music and stuff, and she asked him if he would do it, and he always loved movies and, I guess, liked my work, so he agreed to do that.
Start the test right away.
No, it's okay, but Carter's doing it, and there's something wrong with the baked potato. Either the sour cream is phony, or the chives, or the butter.
I'm really sorry, Matthew. I got up on time. It was Jeffrey.
When did the mad dentist get up to this time?
I don't know. He was just weird.
It's crazy. All dentists are crazy.
Are you late?
No.
He was weird, not the way he usually is. Something was...
All these kinds of shots through glass, through shadowy effects. A lot of this comes from, this kind of film noir look, but you didn't, in the classic film noirs, get this kind of move, this kind of handheld thing. But again, the creepiness of people just looking out of windows, everything with a certain attitude of strangeness or weirdness about it.
It's a rat turd, but the sauce was delicious.
I got your rat.
You find one?
I got it. I really got it. It's a biggie.
People get a declaration of unsanitary on them. I'll talk to you later, okay?
Okay.
What can I do?
Nothing. Don't worry. Go on. I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. Hey, come on. Tell me what I've done. I don't even know.
I understand today's plan.
Yes. Something's come up, Elizabeth. I have to go right back out again.
Now?
This is a continuation of what would have happened as if, you know, the pods moved to a big city as 20 years later. Again, it was a rethinking. It's like you take a classic theme like Hamlet and you can do it in quite another way. As an homage to the earlier version, we thought, do a variation on it. Another guy that we haven't talked about too much is the screenwriter of the original, Daniel Mainering, who did a great job on that script and really didn't get enough credit when the two films were being compared. But in that back shot, you could see the special lighting on Jeffrey's face, the kind of weird, haunted look. Just the lighting here, Mike Chapman did, kind of loneliness of city living as your husband goes off, as you know something's wrong. This is a very San Francisco kind of moment here. Donald Sutherland loves to cook. Donald is a brilliant guy. He's really smart, very funny. I think at the times he worried a little about his hair because he had such an elaborate, hair get-up here. He's a brilliant guy, full of wonderful ideas, and very camera savvy. You know, I mean, he knows exactly where he is and how to make a scene work. And when we came back and looped some of the scenes, as you had to do, Donald was incredibly extraordinary. He'd watch a whole scene once instead of breaking the lines down line by line. He'd watch an entire scene, remember how he'd said it at the time, and on the first take, in sync, repeat his exact rhythms. I've never quite seen it before, although I must say Leonard Nimoy was very good at that too, but Donald was extraordinary. And this scene is, for me, a very seminal scene of the movie, because in order to show what's missing, you have to show the humanity of the people.
Not hungry. I'm not.
You need outside, it's a beautiful mess. Take that meat there, will you? Get the cleaver and chop it up. And hand me some of the ginger, the stuff there that's chopped up there.
You want to know something else? This is really weird. I went to see his sister Nora to talk to her about it. But I couldn't. I stopped myself.
She changed too.
Do you think I'm crazy?
No. Do you want to go see my friend David Kibler?
The psychiatrist?
Not like that. I mean, you talk to him, I mean, he will put things into perspective for you.
I'm not crazy.
No. I'm serious. He would eliminate a lot of things. He would eliminate whether Jeffrey was having an affair, whether he'd become gay, whether he would had a social disease, whether he'd become...
Here, Donald and Brooke Adams seem to me so human. It's the kind of scene you don't ordinarily see in a science fiction movie. It's, a natural, relaxed, and kind of quirky and funny. They're able to show this kind of love for each other that's extraordinary. Brooke showed me she could do that, and I thought, I've got to get that on film. I mean, that effect, imagine what that would cost at ILM. She did it. She gave it to us free. I think the eyes go in opposite directions, too, if I'm not mistaken. But as I was saying, this for me is one of the best kinds of love stories because they're really friends. They just like each other. By the way, there you see the reflection of the Transamerica building. You'll see that throughout the movie, and it's, again, something that's always lurking in the background. As I say, they were the company that was financing United Artists, which was producing the movie.
Morning.
Hello. One, two. Mrs. Tang, this one's got a coffee stain on it.
That's not coffee.
That is coffee. I put it there myself.
Maybe not come out.
You doctor, right?
Me? No, health department, civil servant. You need a doctor?
My wife, sick.
What's wrong with her?
This is real cleaners with our actors.
She's not right?
What I like about this is that being a pod cuts across all races, all sexes, and all religions. Anybody is capable of becoming a pod, and given the choice, a lot of people would do that. There's just another little quirky thing. You know, anytime we saw a little piece of machinery that could do something, we used it. And here, just her moving behind the plastic, again, that motif. Here's the fluff outtakes from people. Donald, of course, doesn't recognize that at this point. I like this kind of cross movement with a zoom lens, moving the opposite direction, zooming in. He sees his friend picking at the banjo.
Hey, Pooch. Hey, Du Bois.
And this shot, of course, just emphasizes the big city quality, you know, the whole importance of Donald's job there. This kind of lighting, Mike Chapman did, you know, wonderful, this pool lighting, and this is a great little move of Chapman's. We did something sort of like that in The Wanderers, where Joey's at the elevator and Perry taps him on the back as sort of a similar move.
What's the matter with you? You all right? Talk to me, Elizabeth.
I was planning to do The Wanderers at this point. In fact, as I was cutting Invasion of the Body Snatchers, I was flying on weekends to casting sessions with my casting director, Scott Rudin, in New York, and then I'd fly back and edit Body Snatchers. These little creepy moves. This is Michael Chapman here, who is the director of photography.
I keep seeing these people all recognizing each other. Something was passing between them all. Some secret. It's a conspiracy. I know it.
There can't be a conspiracy.
I love the cracked windshield here. It just gives the proper outlook on the city. Following strange people in the streets. This is a low, very low dolly. This is in a medical building. We shot this on Van Ness Avenue. But it was a low dolly rising up slightly. And the fact that Jeffrey's a dentist, I think, is perfect. The dentists are the first to go. This was shot in the section which is now Moscone Center. It's one of the most built up areas of the whole city. And back then it was just a desolate urban area. This was scripted, but worked out in a much more complete way as we edited it here.
Jeffrey was meeting all sorts of strange people. Things were being passed between them.
And none of them were people you knew?
I didn't know any of them.
Well, maybe they were patients of Jeffrey's.
Oh, no, no, Matthew. I know they weren't. I followed him all day from one end of town to the other. And everywhere he went, he had these meetings with strange people.
Coming up the stairs here with Jeffrey is one of my favorite pods. And a good friend of mine, Tom Luddy, who was the head of the, right there, that's Tom Luddy, who's produced many films for Francis Coppola and is one of the heads of the Telluride Film Festival, was had been head of the Pacific Film Archives and is one of the most important players in international cinema.
Just think of him as a very intelligent man, which is what he is. It's a book party. He's a celebrity, he's very famous, and you will really like him if you just forget that you think he's a psychiatrist.
I love these kinds of shots, you know, just the shot of the eyes, the crack windshield, you know, these kind of handheld paranoia shots. Again, it's Michael Chapman moving around the city, carrying a camera.
It all seemed normal. Today, everything seemed the same, but it wasn't. It was a nightmare. It really became frightening.
We did more of this later on, but that's a prototypical shot of the city, just faces looking out at you. And if we were shooting the film right, that would all be charged with paranoia, even though it's just an ordinary, everyday thing, not staged in any way. People crossing the streets again, everything that's ordinary, if it's working right, the ordinary seems very unordinary. I think Mike let me shoot a couple of these things. It's the two of us in the back seat.
They've been surrounded by Rommel.
The story Donald is telling, which he never finishes, is it's a British officer. We're trapped in the desert, surrounded by the Germans. I've got good news and bad news for you. The bad news is we've got nothing to eat but camel shit. The good news is there's plenty of it. But she's already heard the story. So like so much of the movie, there's a kind of jocus interruptus that is going on there that adds to the sense of imbalance in the movie. I thought that Kevin McCarthy would provide the continuity from the first movie, which began was 20 years earlier in a small town, and would in a sense be the feeling that he had run for 20 years trying to warn people of this ongoing process, arrived at the big city where he gets killed, and his words, they're here, would in a sense go unheeded, even by our hero in this movie. Kevin and I were working in the Tenderloin when we shot his scene, and the Tenderloin's probably the toughest area of San Francisco, particularly to work in, and there are a lot of homeless, and this one guy was right near where we were shooting, lying with his head against the curb, totally naked, and Kevin was rehearsing the scene where he hits the windshield, and Kevin was doing such a great job. His hands were almost bleeding, and even in the rehearsals, because he was so into this thing. And we were standing near this street person, and he looked up and he said to Kevin, "Wasn't you in the first one?" Kevin said, "Yeah." And the guy said, "That's the better one." So that we already got our first review. We both fell down laughing because we knew there would always be people, you know, who would never see this movie, but it would always say the original was the best.
The Elizabeth.
The book is on. Here's Jeff Goldblum. This is the young Jeff, the thinner, leaner man. And in a way, I miss him before he got built up. And this is my wife, Rose, who's my co-writer on a lot of things. And I think would have been a great actress if she hadn't had to support me as a film director. There in the background, you know, we put mirrors that distorted things. You'll see in this meeting of writers, a number of San Francisco writers who were my friends of mine. But you can see the kind of greenish light, the distortion of the mirrors. You know, all of this was part of our game plan in a way.
There was an ambulance on the way.
Where I am, they follow me. They don't understand what I'm saying.
Well, ignore them. You don't have to prove yourself to anybody.
Well, that's easy for you to say.
The reflections back there. Just something skewed and wacky about the whole thing. And Jeff was perfect with his kind of nervous ego and. Goldblum I'd seen in some small movies, thought he was an extraordinary presence.
Isn't my husband. It's someone who looks like him. He's an imposter.
He's your husband. You know him and I know him.
I had to wait until today. Yeah. He has a scar on the back of his neck. And when his hair...
This is Leonard Nimoy, and the actress he's talking to is Lelia Goldoni, who'd been in John Cassavetes' Shadows, which was one of the most important films for me when I was thinking of making films. She was the star, along with Ben Carruthers, of Shadows. She is a wonderful actress.
Catherine.
Could I just say
please.
One thing?
Catherine. All right, just a minute. Catherine. Just give me a minute, will you? Just a minute. Will you trust me?
Again, you can see the kind of lighting, this kind of preliminary pod lighting, the ultraviolets, the greens. You know, there's just something portentous about this kind of lighting.
Where's Homer? Where's Cousin Zachas? Where's Jack London?
Where's Elizabeth?
I'm afraid.
I know, and I understand. Okay, let me have your hand.
Leonard Nimoy was cast as a writer just because I felt he was known as a rational man and that he could play this rational man here. You know, Leonard was typecast as Spock, and up until this point, you know, I think he'd sort of been lost in the Spock thing, and I just thought that he could play the psychiatrist very well. Here you can see people who are already in one stage of pottiness or another.
We'll all talk. Okay, the three of us?
That's sort of an homage to Dashiell Hammett there on the left, leaning over. But there are a number of writers in here. Herb Gold, Kurt Gentry, writer friends of mine who came. We invited all the writers of San Francisco to be in the scene.
All right, thank you. I never heard anything like it in my life. They don't want to hear about the accident.
Right, of course, it's a big conspiracy.
What's a conspiracy?
Everything.
Excuse me.
And here again, she moves. It's got that kind of strange lighting, you know. People who know something's wrong and something is wrong. It's not paranoia. People know each other in San Francisco, and aberrations in behavior are perhaps more noticeable, you know, more something that's more communal. But Nimoy's character is great because, like so many shrinks, you know, in the Birkenstock sandals and stuff, he's sort of trying to normalize things rather than, he's not fully empathetic with what Brooke Adams is trying to say. You know, he's almost cloyingly sympathetic. If he really were listening to her, maybe he himself would be able to avert what happens to him. In a way, he's much more, certainly much more emotional than Spock, but there's the residue of the Spock logic that's there.
They're changing. They're becoming less human. It's happening all around us.
And this is his sort of approach to therapy, kind of shock therapy, as if to shake her out of it, when in fact, again, he should be listening more closely to what she's saying. There was a scene somewhere early on in the film where all the actors were together trying to decide, you know, how we would play it when some of them had become pods and some hadn't. And Donald was having a really tough time getting his character in, you know, the right stage at that point. It was a moment, I remember it very well, because George Lucas had come to visit me on the set. And in fact, just as George arrived, I had to shut down the set. So I went in with my actors. George sat outside for 2 hours waiting for me to come out. And the result of it all was that they all were sympathetic with Donald's play. But I remember Leonard Nimoy saying to me, whatever Donald wants to do is fine, because I know how my character will respond to whatever he does.
Okay.
Leonard was an extremely well-trained actor. Leonard's also been a very good director, too. I think he sort of got typecast there, unfortunately, and this was an attempt to break him out of that.
Looks fine to me. She is upset, Jack.
To really finally make it go, we needed a name, and Mike Medavoy had represented Donald Sutherland. Donald Sutherland had been out of the country for many years doing European films, Fellini and various other great European directors. And I'd always admired Donald, you know, thought he was wonderful, but he hadn't really been around the country. And he came back, read the script, and I met with him, and suddenly we were in business together. Brooke Adams I'd seen in Days of Heaven, and I thought she was extraordinary. And by the way, another project that I had been working on was a small, low-budgeted project called Star Trek. which Paramount wanted to make as a low budget, a $3 million movie. They really didn't know what they had there. And somebody called and asked me if I'd be interested. And I said, sure. My friend George Lucas developed and was in the process of shooting Star Wars at the time. I spent about 8 months working on developing Star Trek and was able to get them to push the budget up. But the word on Star Wars was bad around Hollywood. The idea, in fact, the plug had been pulled on that movie so that George had to kind of rush to a conclusion. In the wake of all of this, the phone rang, and it was producer Jerry Eisenberg saying, we got a problem. The people who were then running the studio at Paramount said a line that I think is a wonderful line: there is no future in science fiction. And they decided to pull the Star Trek project. They thought maybe it could only exist on television. And it was a couple of years before they finally made the first Star Trek. My version was really built around Leonard Nimoy. It was the character of Spock. And I thought we could have this grand adventure in outer space. So that essentially is how I met Leonard Nimoy. There's a bin in the background with the fluff in it that he leans against. Veronica Cartwright was a great actress. As a child, she'd been in Hitchcock's The Birds. She has the leading role as the child in The Birds. I just had a great time working with her, and Veronica later worked with me in The Right Stuff. This was actually a set that we made inside an empty store near Clement Street, and it was sort of model, of course, on the Calistoga mud baths. This is all one shot here. Starts on one side of him and moves through the door, revealing the whole set. And I really like doing things in one shot as much as possible. It just makes you stay with it. You're not being manipulated by the camera as much. These are the mud baths. In the scene, of course, Jeff has to shed a tear as he's walking down the hall. You know, and that's what makes the one take all the more impressive.
Why can't
give me that towel.
You are really going to get hurt one of these days. You've got to learn to be more.
This is my brother-in-law, Dave Fisher, who helped me on many films. Psychologist himself, reading Velikovsky.
Nancy, shut the music off.
It's for the plants, Stan.
Screw the plants. I hate the music.
It's wonderful for my plants. They just love it. Plants have feelings, you know, just like...
You know, all of this kind of movement of behind plastic or... you know, this was one of the ways we shot a lot of the things.
Come on, Nancy. Turn the music off.
Relax. Now, you're not going to enjoy this if you don't.
See, that's the early Jeff Goldblum before weightlifting. That's Dave Fisher actually wearing my hat. That was the hat I directed the film in. I used to call it my lucky hat until I did a couple of movies that didn't do well, so it became my unlucky hat. Rose told me not to wear it anymore.
You've been sitting in that mud too long.
I got it on Great North Film Minnesota Raid from Western Costume. It was a great old Western hat, and I used to wear it on every movie. Just the breezes blowing here adds to the aura of, you know, that sense of presence, that something's there. I mean, they're not only here, but, you know, as a theme, but the sense that something's there is important. I love the way Chapman lit this, where his eyes go totally black because of the rearview mirror. Because ordinarily, the minute you saw that, you would change it if it were an accident. But we were looking for those things, so that things that would ordinarily, in most movies, be photographically incorrect, just as politically correct, we were looking for the opposite in a way.
Jeffrey! You all right? I'll see you tomorrow morning.
Thank you, Matthew. You've really made me feel better. And I'm going to think about what your friend Kimmer said.
Okay.
Thanks.
It's a wonderful move. The lighting is beautiful. And it's simple, it's just a simple shot.
Jack? Honey, where are you? I don't want to disturb you if you're thinking, but I could sure do with some Chinese food.
Veronica Cartwright and Jeff Goldblum used to, they're both great comedians, and they would come dancing through the set like they were the dancing Belichicks that I'd be trying to rehearse, and they'd come tap dancing through doing a pas de deux, and they claimed they lived in a pas de terre, and we had all kinds of pod jokes and pod puns.
Report certain things when you run into them, like a contagious disease or a dead body in a place of business.
Jack, would you let him look at it?
You found the body?
No, not necessarily. We didn't. No,
I thought it was Jack.
Veronica Cartwright, of course, is, in a strange way, by the rules of science fiction, her character is the one who really understands what's going on, or comes to understand what's going on, even though in some way she seems like the wackiest character in the piece, but she is the one who believes in science fiction and believes in plants responding to music and believes in monkeys and being mated with people from outer space and so forth. So she's somebody who we think is just being hysterical here, but really understands a lot of what's going on.
Because I think Jack is right.
There's a wonderful line in here. I think it was Rick Richter's line. You don't know where it's been. It's another cautionary line your mother always gives you when you bring a dead rat home or something.
Touch it. You don't know where it's been.
No respiration.
It's got no fingerprints.
No fingerprints?
Later you can put together all the pieces in the evolution of pods. It's a biological puzzle that we put together prior to making the movie, but everything, if you were to draw a chart, this would be, one of the stages before pods became human lookalikes.
Oh, Jack!
Who are you calling?
Elizabeth.
Why? Why are you calling Elizabeth?
You?
Why?
Hello? Can you hear me? It's Matthew. Elizabeth.
By the way, here you can see Brooke Adams beginning to disintegrate here. Her face, because she's groggy, is beginning to have the desiccated, dried look that comes to people whose physical bodies are being sucked into pottiness here. It takes place, within an evening, certainly, or within a night. The whole thing can evolve from the little plant into a pod, into what we later see, these big pod-shaped things, into a full person, and does it while people are sleeping, so it goes on unnoticed.
A friend of mine is in trouble.
The costume designer on the film was Aggie Rogers, who's gone on to do many, many other films, and she did a really nice job just getting everybody right. You know, Jeff Goldblum would be wearing this kind of war surplus poet's outfit here.
Don't fall asleep. Here, sweetie.
Thanks, sweetie.
See, again, this the way we've done this, you know, and Chapman has lit the, you know, the silhouette of the dark figures, the green, the tinges of green, you know, these are the colors of kind of ominousness, of colors of the pod universe. The music is, you know, to my mind, one of the best scores, certainly, that I've ever worked with, and I think one of the best scores I can recall on film. And it was done by Denny Zeitlin. It's the only score Denny's ever done. Denny was a friend of mine from college. I've known Denny for many, many years. He's a psychiatrist practicing in Marin County and San Francisco, and a well-known, if not great, jazz pianist and composer. I took Bob Solo to see Denny. I just had the feeling that Denny would understand the nature of paranoia, and he had some very avant-garde techniques in his jazz playing. And because we were friends, we worked really closely throughout on the score. He always worked with, you know, those were the early years when videotapes were just available to composers, and Denny had a big... one of those big old Sonys out at his place, and we would go out. I remember he worked with an assistant named Phil Sawyer, who was savvy on not only film music, but film sound effects. And so that a lot of Denny's score moves into the sound effects area. And I've asked Denny to do scores on other films, but he said this one was so hard and so difficult that he just doesn't really have the time or inclination to do it. And that's a shame. And making him a health inspector gave him a kind of a mock scientific background. It's not the usual scientist looking for these things, but it's a guy who certainly is on the periphery of science. He knows that within each pod soul there's a rat turd. See, this is why it was wonderful to shoot in a big city, because it's full of, everybody's got all of these kind of protective devices, and yet there's always something lurking. You know, we're always afraid of the outside coming in. I love these kinds of angles for this movie. Kind of movements like that, creepy, the camera creeping down and following him around. And what Jeffrey's watching there is, you know, pods just watch anything that's on, which is sort of where commercials are trying to get us. It's part of the podding of America is, you know, these extensive commercials that we just watch while our minds go out the window, really. Mike Chapman and I talked about everything. This was, as I say, a wonderful collaboration. We've done this a lot, but it was really fun to work on this. We just sort of, it was the sense, we had all these rules of trying to, not go by the ordinary rules in a way, go with the kind of constant little camera movements, creepy angles. As I say, certain scenes were lit certain ways, some nice little movement in there. There was a kind of fluidity at all times, and everything was meant to be both threatening and fun. It was, in a way, we were trying to create this little circus hall of mirrors here. You can see the mirror there, using the mirror as one of the little points of light there on the side. You're limited as to where your camera can go in these real places. This isn't a studio where we're able to knock walls out and move around. And yet, you can see, suddenly the staircase, as in film noir, becomes, another dimension. There goes Jeffrey up with the wastebasket to get the outtake, so to speak, of his wife's person. A lot of night shooting on this film. That was the only part that was hard. Night shooting's always hard. And again, in this place, which was, if we had a studio, it would have been a set, but we were shooting in a storefront, really. But because there were so many scenes, I think I shot every possible conceivable angle in this little place. It was one of the last angles I could find that we hadn't done yet in here.
He opened its eyes.
You actually saw that?
I saw its nose bleed, white hair that touched my hand. There's something in here.
When I was writing Unbearable Lightness of Being with the French writer Jean-Claude Carrière, we went out to Calistoga and sat in adjoining mud baths and talked about the characters.
Face it, Belichick. You've got some friends who enjoy playing practical jokes.
I don't have any friends, Dr. Kibner.
Then some enemies.
Look. Who opened this up?
Up now, Matthew.
Police, I would like to report a body.
Take her to my place fast. Don't let anybody in until we get back there.
You you know, if the film is working right, any traveling shot on the street, just by pointing the camera out there, it appears like a haunted city in a way.
You both saw it, right?
Oh, I really want to talk, sir. It might be Benel.
Mr. Benel, why don't you show me where you saw
it? It's right up here.
Where's Elizabeth?
The chief police inspector here is Tom Dahlgren, who was an actor with Magic Theater, but was also a banker who was getting bank loans for a lot of the filmmakers in San Francisco, and Sam Shepard and so forth, and people were buying ranches or homes up in this area. And Tom was later in The Right Stuff and in Rising Sun. I used him in both of those movies. This guy right here.
So then you took Elizabeth Driscoll out of here.
No, I took her from there. Her other body was in here.
Now, this is all handheld. To cover a shot like this, or a scene like this, with all the cuts, with all the requirements, would have taken hours and hours, and if not days. So many people, so much frenzy going on. So Chapman is doing it handheld, dressed all in black, so because there's so many mirrors and reflections in here. We covered it three or four different ways, and then later with Doug Stewart went in and cut the scene together. So this was not a classically shot scene. It was all staged, rehearsed, and Chapman sort of, you know, wheeling around in here like that. Just, he's almost like a character in the scene. And it's got a wonderful effect to it. I haven't seen it done that. That's this kind of thing done that much in film, particularly Hollywood films.
I have to pick up some of her clothes.
All right.
There's the Transamerica building again, fog coming in. Leonard came up with the idea of wearing this strange little hand thing, you know, whatever. It's one of the earliest known cases of carpal tunnel syndrome. It's just a little quirky thing that he thought his character would have, an unexplained quirk.
Nancy, you saw it open.
This is shot up at the top of Telegraph Hill in the actual house that exists there, the one that Donald Sutherland is living in, I think because of all the night shooting that we did up there and the commotion that was caused. Subsequent films have had a tough time working up on Telegraph Hill. I think the neighbors got up in arms, but... Again, we didn't do any studio shooting for stuff like this. The city now is receptive to films, but back then there weren't that many films being shot up here. So, you know, to some degree breaking ground in terms of features. There weren't that many features back 20 years ago that were being shot up here.
What is happening?
People are being duplicated. And once it's happened to you, you're part of this thing.
In the 70s, a lot changes, and you have a lot of therapies that are trying to tell us and make us understand that everything's all right. But as we all know, everything's not all right. And in fact, I feel that, you know, in a way, everything that was being talked about in Body Snatchers has come to pass, and that we are now living in the world largely controlled by pods. The editor of the film was Doug Stewart, who I'd worked with on a number of films, Great North Field, Minnesota Raid, White Dawn. We did this one. He won an Oscar as one of the editors on The Right Stuff. And I learned a lot from Doug, who's since passed away. Doug really taught me a lot about editing. He was a great editor who understood how to make dialogue scenes work, how to fold one thing under another, which to me is the real magic of film editing. It's that thing, so you know, where the actor off camera is kept alive, you know, by the stitching and the weaving of a, and whether it's an art or, I think as Doug always insisted, it was just a great craft. He was a great craftsman and a great man. He was a great friend of mine and a great editor, and I miss him. See, this is the actual deck of that house. You know, we didn't jump to another look. And there, between them, perfectly, is Pod Central. In a way, you know, it's the Transamerica building, the company that's backing this movie. I don't think they got it, but it was sort of our in-joke was that we were always being watched as we were making the movie. You know, they could have been up there on the top looking down at us doing this movie. But I love just putting them in between the two actors here on the frame. And back then it was a very controversial building. I happen to like that building, but a lot of people didn't like it at the time, thought it was too futuristic for San Francisco. I remember at the time that Donald was giving Jeff a pretty hard time of it. Sometimes he'd be really a little tough on him. And I said to him, why are you so tough on Jeff? And he said, when I did the Dirty Dozen, Lee Marvin was tough on me. So they became good friends afterwards. In fact, I think Donald produced a movie right after this and hired Jeff for it. It's sort of the training of an actor.
Look it, I have seen these flowers all over. They're growing like parasites on other plants. All of a sudden, where are they coming from?
Plants all over the place. You know, bars are filled with plants, hanging plants and so forth. And, you know, the awareness of the plant life that surrounds us, you know, I think it just heightens the creepiness of the movie. And here Veronica's sort of telling, in a way, what a form of what might have happened.
We would never even notice it, not from the impurities that we have. I mean, we eat junk and we breathe junk.
Look, I don't know where they're coming from, but I know I feel as though I've been poisoned today. We've got to take those flowers in and have them analyzed. This is the only thing we know. There's something here.
Now, they could start getting into our systems and screwing up our genes like DNA. Recombining us, changing us. Of course, this is just the same way those rocket ships landed thousands of years ago so those spacemen could mate with monkeys and apes and create the human race. It's happening now.
I like a frame like this where you can just get a little peek at the outside to see that we're on the actual location there. This is to show that it's not a set at all. It's the real. You can see City Hall down there, and this is the Civic Center. And again, just this is just random shots of people walking out there. We didn't stage this or anything. We just pointed the camera out, and suddenly everything seems kind of solitary and creepy out there.
Can I help you?
Yes, my name is Matthew Bennell, B-E-N-N-E-L-L. I'm a deputy public health inspector.
Yeah, is this another call about imposters?
Yes.
We're the first agency you've called.
That's my voice talking to Donald. I decided that in order to really make a film about pods, I had to become one. So there I am, a proof of my own poddiness.
This is a busy lab, Elizabeth. We're not supposed to test flowers. They go to the department.
This is Gary Goodrow, who was an original member, I believe, of the committee comedy team, a longtime San Francisco actor. And I like, you know, again, these kinds of drifting one-shot movements that come all the way around and just keep going to tie in her and off her look here. We begin to move into this kind of strange shot. And, you know, that all has to be timed. Focus has to be done just right. But it's, to me, is much more effective than a lot of cutting around.
Hello?
Mr. Bedell?
Yes.
You're with the health department?
Yes, that's right.
This is Ted Jessup, the mayor's special assistant.
Yes.
You've come across something strange in the last few days?
Yes.
Well, I'd like to suggest that we meet in Union Square. We can't talk over the phone.
Right away.
This is Union Square, downtown San Francisco.
Yeah.
Now, don't say a word to anyone. Keep it quiet.
Whatever you say. Operator, no.
Chapman and I are walking around the city. There, actually, that's me right there, trying to get on the phone booth. And there you can see I'm wearing that hat. But we decided to just walk with Donald downtown. Chapman has the camera wrapped in a blanket under his arm. And this is nothing is staged here. It's just Donald and us walking through the city. Again, with that idea that everything would be creepy and pod-infested and pod-inhabited if we had done things right up here at this point. This is the city as it is. And he's just, in a way, a face on the street. It's end of the day. And it has a, you know, a kind of frenetic thing as, you know, we're sort of approaching the end of time.
Paranoia, Mr. Bunnell. No.
We're not done all right.
Looks like Mr. Bunnell.
Seen anything?
We don't want to create a panic.
No, we have the primary authority in this matter.
Be extremely cautious.
Now what?
I think the horizon is bright. People are returning to normal.
No. She all right. She better now. Much better now.
She much better now. That was one of the most quoted lines in the film at the time of its release. Rose and I still use that on various occasions. One of the things that could be listened to on the soundtrack is that as the film progresses, organic sounds are removed from the soundtrack. That is, dogs barking in the night, insect sounds, anything of nature is being absorbed by this pod invasion. And you begin hearing more and more sounds of trucks, of garbage trucks, of fire trucks, of just the harsh traffic sounds of the night. It was a subtle thing, but hopefully it plays into part of the harshness of the world that closes in upon our actors and our cast, and which is closing in on us, too, in society. We're losing touch with, you know, just the kind of hum of nature. Ben Burt did the sound effects, or the major sound effects on this, and Ben Burt has subsequently gone on to work on all of George Lucas's movies, and was the major, you know, the guy who constructed all the Star Wars sound effects and so forth. He's one of the ranking sound effects geniuses. He constructed, for example, the pod shriek. It was a combination of a lot of things, including a pig squeal. And we were trying to get the most horrific sounds that we could find, but, you know, all blended into some sort of horrifying organic sound. And we wanted his sound effects and Denny Zeitlin's score to find points where they could almost blend or take off one from the other. And we'll see in upcoming sequences how sound effects and music can be almost indistinguishable. Leonard Nimoy is now, as we know, is a pod, but as a pod, he is almost the same guy that he was, only maybe slightly less so, or more so. If he's just emphasizing some of the qualities of logic and cunning that he might have had as a shrink earlier on, it's almost hard to tell if he has been changed, but now that he is a pod, his purposes are totally to podize the universe and make others as he is. Here we see the Transamerica building, the pyramid in the background, and we're now about to observe some other steps in the process, the mysterious process of how the pods, who we've been following since the beginning, attain a human form. They get you while you sleep. That's one of the things, you know, which is in accord with all the great religious teachings that say, wake up. At the beginning, we've seen how Jeffrey was essentially a couch pod-tato. The special effects were done by Del Ream and Russ Hesse, and the makeup was Tom Boorman and Edward Enriquez. It was the same kind of approach that I later applied to The Right Stuff, where I just felt that, you know, there was something human about the nature and scope of the effects, and that we should try to keep the budget down and keep these effects on a human level, because it is about humanity and the loss thereof. Here, once again, the effect is done by reversing. This is all shot in reverse. We started up here and panned down, and by doing it all in reverse, it seems like things are growing. But again, to emphasize the organic nature, this was not an invasion by metal ships. Too much science fiction imagines that there are, you know, some guys out there with wrenches and screwdrivers or blowtorches and, you know, planning to invade that way. This is, in a way, probably a more accurate scenario if the invasion is to come. Things borne by the wind and blooming here. Again, you know, it's this kind of breathing sounds, some of which I used in a variation in a film I did called The White Dawn, where there was some breathing, the Eskimo breathing, one Eskimo breathing into another Eskimo's mouth, and we enhanced that kind of effect in here to turn it into this kind of horrific breathing effect of things sucking in the air that our living characters breathe. The midget is in the first form being born, and then we go, you know, from one size person to another. And these effects obviously took hours of makeup. We were shooting on, not in studios, so we were all pretty much up in that house up there with all kinds of slimy people in various stages walking around, coming out into the backyard, lying down. And again, it's one of the things that's fun about low-budget filmmaking is you're forced to invent things, and there's often a vitality that's missing in larger-budgeted movies where all of the kind of bizarreness is sort of taken away and institutionalized in a way. And the making of movies like this for filmmakers and actors is just so much more vivid. Here's Donald Sutherland himself becoming his alternate self. And there you see on the face the same process of disintegration and desiccation that was going on. The sound effects are nicely mixed. Mark Berger, who has mixed many films since then, this I think was perhaps his first feature, certainly one of his first features, and he's mixed hundreds of, won many Oscars since this time.
Huh?
it makes you rethink gardening, hanging out in your yard late at night. It's not just raccoons moving out there.
Like the others.
Elizabeth, wake up. They're growing out of these pods.
I'll get the police.
Get you when you sleep. Sit up! Elizabeth, would you wake up?
Hello, police.
Officer, I would like to report 4 bodies in my backyard.
You all right?
Wait right there, Mr. Bennett.
The sense of trying to call a civic agency or a government agency when you're in trouble. The realization that the CIA, the FBI, their pods are ready. Is it paranoia or is it truth here?
Who are you calling?
Washington.
What, the CIA, the FBI, they're all pods already?
No, I've got a friend in the Justice Department. I know his home number. I can dial direct, and I can avoid the San Francisco.
What are you going to tell him?
Oh, my God. They grow out of those pods. They cut our power.
I love that chair spinning around. That was, again, the way things move. We're not often aware of those things. They all become weird if the film is working right.
Matthew, they're barricading the street.
No.
Now we're beginning to see, you know, the combination of music and sound effects working together. And the marvelous lighting of Mike Chapman's, you know, the kind of limning of figures, backlighting. Really, you know, this is, you know, it's virtually black and white lighting, but with, you know, the almost like hand-tinted color, really.
Do you have a gun?
No.
What are we going to do?
Out the back door.
Around that way, under the stairs. Go on. I'll catch up with you.
This is a scene that a lot of people objected to in the film. They thought it was should be censored. It was too scary and horrifying. And yet, compared to the violence you see in most films, it's really very minor. But because it's the sense of a man having to confront his own internal horrors, it's was extremely shocking to people at the time. I like the hands just reaching around there. It's sort of like a little sculpture of pod hands there. This all takes place on Telegraph Hill, Napier Lane. It's sort of the back end of Telegraph Hill going down to the Embarcadero. These types of shots are sort of, real body snatchers kinds of shots. An unknown force is pursuing us in the night, which is what makes it a great nightmare, I think. Mike Chapman really playing out the film noir lighting, you know, these wonderful shadows that the characters sort of grow into their shadows. That, of course, is the Embarcadero, but there's that, what they used to call a Dutch tilt to the camera. This was essentially the shot that was on a lot of the posters of the movie at the time. Characters slightly backlit, running for their lives. This is where Jeff Goldblum's character decides to be a hero. His wonderful moment, a guy who's been self-absorbed and cowardly, suddenly decides he's going to take on the pods and try to save all the others. And I thought Denny Zeitlin wrote a wonderful heroic cue for this moment. You know, Transamerica building, the helicopter, and this zany, crazed run for freedom. Again, this is all hard shooting. You know, it's all through the night. You know, night shooting is just, it's just rough. It gets cold out there, and you make low-budget movies, and you really don't have all the conveniences that you might have on a Hollywood film. This is all, again, that twisted angle, and I just thought I'd try to tell the story in some sort of shorthanded way here of what it's like to be walking down a street with alien feet all around you. It's on Market Street in San Francisco. First of all, you can really see the period the film was shot in, you know, with the flared pants and everything, but we wanted to just have, you know, sort of representative of all classes, that everybody is, the whole city is joining forces to go against the outsiders. And here, you know, coming on Broadway, you know, in the kind of girly shows that sort of trying to lure people in to see these hollow shows. I love the guy's wrist watch. He actually was a guy who owned some of these places here, the guy whose hand we use there. This is now Don Siegel, the great, great director of so many terrific films, including the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers. And Don was pretty terrified for a tough guy. Once he had to be on camera, he was a little nervous, but he really got into it here.
Type H. Repeat type H.
610 confirmed.
Some night, eh?
280 cell phone rapid.
Yeah.
And we shot this in the Broadway tunnel, and if you really hear this on a stereo system, this scene was designed by sound, essentially, so that as these motorcycles go by, the sound should sweep from in front of you to behind you on the screen. And it was, at that time, Dolby thought it was one of the best uses of Dolby sound that they'd ever had. Any good director is there through the entire mix. And I'm even in on the premixes of all my films. And you know, it's just very hard to not be there if you're working, if you're involved in sound design in any way yourself. The director has to really be there. I mean, you know, I've been fortunate enough to work with the top people, or many of the top people in the business, mixers and sound effects people, but you really often have to explain, particularly if you shot the scene with sound in mind, how you want it done and make sure that it's done that way.
Oh, nice.
Oh!
both of them.
As Donald and Brooke Adams ran here, I don't know if it was this shot or one of these shots, they had a little competitiveness between themselves. Donald ran every morning before we started shooting, but Brooke always claimed she could beat him in a race. And in fact, as they went running off into the night, she claims even in high heels, she was able to beat him.
Harry, Pooch.
So here we see that Donald tries to wake him up, and he injures the pod that's been placed by his friend and the dog. So there's a pod that is about to develop some sort of mutation there. There's Mike Chapman, the director of photography. Trying to show the struggles of human beings in a world that is intent on becoming inhuman. This is all, by the way, shot in the actual, again, the actual locations, which look down on Civic Center. And it's nice to be able to tie in, you know, the set that you're actually working on with the interior to exterior, not have to be shooting in a studio and then run off to do a point of view elsewhere.
Be able to stop them.
Yes, we will.
We can't. Look at, they control the whole city.
We'll find a way somehow.
Oh, Matthew, I can't go on. I want to go to sleep. I can't stay awake anymore.
You have to. You have to stay awake.
this got probably the biggest laugh for audiences of the film.
Take some.
What are they?
Speed, it'll keep us awake.
How many are you supposed to take?
It says take one.
Take five.
Easier if we'd just gone to sleep last night.
David, no.
Oh my God, no! No! No, Matthew!
Don't touch her! David, don't let them touch her! David, don't let them touch her!
No,
don't let them touch her!
Please!
What are you going to do? Please, listen to me.
Please, we'll leave the city. Please, Jeffrey.
David, please, let us go. We won't
leave the city.
We
won't tell anyone. You don't have to leave the city. Nothing changes. You can have the same life, the same clothes, the same car.
But what happens to us?
You'll be born again into an untroubled world. Free of anxiety, fear.
Wait.
Hate.
David, you're killing us.
That's not true. David's right. Your minds and memories will be totally absorbed. Everything remains intact.
You've never agreed with him in your life before. What are you talking about? What are you...
This is all, of course, done with, you know, retractable needles. Always works, though. Especially for people who don't like shots.
David, you're killing me. David.
I want somebody in transportation to report to the Grove Street turnaround.
David!
There's that lighting that signifies pause, that ultraviolet look.
I hate you.
We don't hate you. There's no need for hate now.
I was very disappointed when Star Trek didn't pan out. I was kind of amazed because I really believed in science fiction. I believed that the audience really had a thirst for it. And of course, about 3 weeks after they canceled Star Trek, Star Wars came out, and shortly thereafter, Close Encounters of the Third Kind. But, you know, they had already made up their minds, and the idea... It has always, you know, recurred to me that had we done that original and done a great movie out of it, think how many more sequels they could have had, and they would have really been, even though they did extremely well with that and continue to do well with that series, you know, that was probably the crest of this kind of science fiction movie, and I believe they really would have had an enormous hit with Star Trek. And I liked Star Trek because I felt that, you know, dealt with mature adult themes. It wasn't a kind of juvenile science fiction, and there was a chance to do things like that. So at some point, Bob Solo approached me to see if I was interested in doing Body Snatchers. I had never read the Jack Finney novel until we really began working on the script, and we all began together, Bob Solo, Rick Richter, and myself. We all started on this at the same time, and the novel had a number of things in it that hadn't been included. Primarily, I think, the kind of genealogy, the evolution of the pods themselves, where they came from, and the things that made it more, much more clearly a science fiction movie rather than a film of urban paranoia, perhaps McCarthyite paranoia, really. And I don't mean Kevin McCarthy. I'm speaking of the other McCarthy.
How are we going to get out of here?
Through the door. Come on.
I love science fiction. I'm always looking for science fiction projects. And Peter, my son, who produces my films, loves science fiction as well. And we've tried to get a few science fiction things going. It's just, for whatever reason, we just haven't been able to get something going. But if the right science fiction project comes along and we were able to set it up, you know, we're ready to go.
What's that?
Here again, Denny's Island score is really like a sound effects track almost.
Elizabeth!
the book is written in the first person, but the decision to not use narration really was based on the fact that I think narration tends to flatten out the screen, tends to make the film more or less two-dimensional. It takes away some of the challenges that the eye has in a film without narration.
Watch over each other.
Okay.
That's fine, Jack.
We're going to beat them. Okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Veronica Carter was doing back there was giving the human contract, really. You know, watch over each other while we sleep and how to survive in a world that's it's the primer on how to survive in a world that's dominated by pods.
Hey, the lines are over there.
Yes, Station 5, proceeding as per Plan B, awaiting inhibitor unit.
Station 5, come in.
XB-25, in front of the health department, request instructions.
Your line, please.
XB-25.
It means Sausalito. Please keep moving right along. Sausalito only, please. Ask if you have a question.
The yellow zone.
Well, that was done on the dog by Tom Berman, really, who did the mask and people he worked with. I believe, I may be wrong, but that's the face of Bob Solo. It's an homage to my producer, Bob Solo. But that is extraordinary when the tongue comes out of the mouth. That whole little thing has a deep resonance. The banjo player, the dog with the man's face, the evolution gone awry, and the possibilities of those things. And now we're into all kinds of genetic aberrations and stuff. Out to the waterfront area of San Francisco around 3rd and 22nd Street.
Come on, get up.
We're now arriving at what we always refer to as Pod Central, you know, the warehouse of pods.
See them? This is where they grow them. This is where they cultivate them.
Don't show any emotion. Don't laugh. And if you don't have a lot of fun, you can be a pod.
What are we going to do? There are so many.
We've got to figure out a way of stopping them.
Ah!
Can you walk?
I'll try.
Here, hold on to me. Try and walk.
Many years before I shot this movie, I was drinking with Frank Pearson, who was written many great Hollywood movies, Dog Day Afternoon, been president of the Writers Guild. I mean, we were in a Scottish bar in San Francisco, and we were listening to Amazing Grace played on bagpipes, and we both said, someday we want to use that in a movie, and I found the chance to be the first one to use that in the scene that's coming up here. Played on the bagpipes, it's a song filled with hope, and this is a film about hope and the dashing of hope and lost hopes.
Chips, we can get away. I'll go down there. I'll be right back. Stay here. Stay here.
Brooke Adams' last shot as a human being in the movie. What's also great about, shooting it in a big city was that all the modern ways of trying to get out of the city, whether by airplane, by car, or by ship, they could all be cut off in some way or another, as opposed to this being a story that just took place in a small town. See this stuff being shipped all over now. I might have a pod or two around somewhere, or my pod's missing. I went to sleep one night and it was there. This film was actually mixed at Zoetrope, at Coppola's facility, which was then in San Francisco on Pacific Avenue. It's a facility that's long since gone, but it was an area where I did The Wanderers, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, and was part of Francis Coppola's ideal of setting up a studio in San Francisco away from Hollywood. And it was a marvelous place while it lasted. Francis now mixes out at his place out in Napa. And I've since, used ILM and other places, for mixing movies. But this was a pretty much an all San Francisco film, all shot here. The composer was from San Francisco. We had the best sound effects people in the world. And Mark Berger's a great mixer, and we all were able to work up here.
The boat's there, Elizabeth. The boat's there. It's going to take us away.
There's nothing to be afraid of.
I know Brooke was reluctant to do it, but I think she became convinced of the rightness of being nude out there, and she was a good sport about doing it. And there might have been some consideration with the censors at the time. I don't remember. But we really had to show another complete step in the process of podification. You sort of can put it all together now as to how the organic way in which it all happens, as opposed to, the earlier film where you just really saw the one scene where the pods were sort of growing there. We wanted to do the whole organic thing. And, now you see on Earth how they're creating actual greenhouses for proliferation centers. And this was, you know, the biggest set of the movie. It was done in a warehouse along the waterfront in San Francisco. I wanted to use a stuntman, a stunt double for Donald here, but he wouldn't have anything to do with that. He wanted to do his own stunts. And I was standing next to an assistant, a guy who worked with Donald, and he said to me right about at this point, "My God, don't you realize he's one of the clumsiest men alive?" And we're down there watching Donald do all, I mean, this is actually Donald doing stuff that very few actors would dream of doing, because every step up here is dangerous, and he's doing a high wire act without a net up here. It's great for a director when you work with an actor who wants to do it all, but it's it's risking everything. Not exactly James Bond, but it's an ordinary man doing what he can, doing what you or I might do in our best moments, trying to save humanity, and without resorting to super karate kicks or you know, the next generation of weaponry. Pods themselves can die. Donald's actually doing all that himself again, you know, dangling and hanging, and very dangerous. There might be two cameras here. I don't remember exactly. Just to, you know, make sure that we get it all. This is Donald doing this, all of this himself. Extraordinary. And as he runs here, there's a blast there. Unfortunately, this guy got caught in it, who an extra hadn't listened to the instructions. He wanted to, he was trying to get onto camera, and he really was badly burnt in that shot, or his hands were burnt, because he didn't allow the space between Donald and himself that he was supposed to. This is still the waterfront area. It's around China Basin, actually.
We'll get him. Can't stay away.
the transition from the flashlight to daylight and the feeling that perhaps he's the only man who survives. It looks like all the children are about to be turned into pods as he walks down Market Street, San Francisco. Life goes on, only now is a life run by pods. The lab is all you can tell by the postures, by the attitudes, by the machinery working and functioning, that everything is pod-like. There's Elizabeth doing what she always did, except with a slightly different look. And that look in his face, what is that look? Matthew returns to his job, doing what he was doing earlier, cutting things out. Papaya is probably cutting something out from a health magazine, because this is, after all, the health department. We don't know if it's the next day or a while after, but it's very soon after. And now there's some sort of convening of people. And is he following Veronica Cartwright's advice of, don't show any emotion, be with them? I love this tracking shot, slightly high angle on a dolly with pods keeping the proper distance between one another and moving. And that's a nice moment, the way the door closes and just leaves Brooke Adams in the window. And is that a sense of remorse, of long lost love? What's going on here? Now outside City Hall, the trees, this is how the trees were trimmed, gnarled, devoid of leaves. Somehow the only organic matter that seems to be really surviving are the pods. And I love the low angle tracking shot and the dissonant Amazing Grace that's playing on the soundtrack. And I hadn't told anybody the ending of the movie. The studio wanted to know. I didn't tell anybody. I told Rick Richter how I thought it should end. He and I agreed. We told Bob Solo. And then that morning, we told Donald Sutherland, who agreed to do the ending. He thought it was a good idea. He agreed to do the ending that way. And the studio, despite all the times they'd asked, didn't know how the film was going to end until I actually saw it at a screening up. I think the first screening was up at George Lucas's screening room. We certainly didn't want to add the ending that said, we'll call the FBI and everything will be hunky-dory once again. It's a film about, you know, the process of change and something, whatever, if it's a metaphor, it's about, you know, the metaphor of humanity being lost, of a certain type of person, a certain type of life that can vanish or fade away or disappear or become transformed in some way. To some degree, I think that the film that we made has, while not giving answers, maybe has certainly raised some questions that are really applicable, perhaps more so now than ever.